Hi everybody. So as Robert said, it's very sad that we cannot meet physically, but I mean that's it, and we will hopefully we will have other occasions to meet. So so you can see that there are many slides on my presentation, but this is the full presentation for the three talks. So don't be too worried. I will not do everything right now. Okay, so if you have questions, I think that you can put it on the chat, and I or Robert maybe we will relay these questions. So I will speak, as Robert said, on the estimation of conditional quantiles, and this is part of part of this talks contains works that have been done with Kevin Elidi-Kozak, who is a PhD student in Lyon, and Didier Rullière, who is a colleague in École des Mines de Saint-Étienne, and Antoine Ousselio Calvert, who is a former student, former PhD student, and he is now in Rennes. So I will begin with some expectations, some motivation on why I decided to speak about conditional quantiles. What are the main motivations? And then we will see mainly two ways to deal with this. So that's the next next part. So okay. So I will give several examples on conditional quantiles, and then my main motivation will be on quantile-oriented sensitivity indices. So I will explain a bit what it is about, and then I will present some computing and estimation issues. And after that, the presentation will contain mainly two parts. The first one will be focused on the elliptic distributions, and mainly on how to estimate high-level quantiles for elliptic distributions. And finally, I will present more non-parametric estimation, which are based on random forest estimations and focused on the quantile-oriented sensitivity indices. Okay, so why we are interested in conditional quantiles, and firstly, why we are interested in quantiles. So I think that most of you, and probably every one of you, knows that quantiles are interested quantities, especially for finance, insurance, but also in many other fields. And so for finance and insurance, quantiles are named value at risk, but this is simply quantiles. So you have just here the definition of what is a quantile. This is just the inverse function, the inverse of the repartition function at a certain level alpha. So of course alpha is between 0 and 1. And as you know, probably risk metrics popularize this risk measure as this quantity as a risk measure for evaluating financial portfolios and insurance risks. And you know also probably that Basel Committee puts the value at risk as for the internal approach for the capital risk management. And also in insurance, the value at risk is the risk measure that has been retained in Solvency II. So this is just to recall why we are interested in quantile, and now I will present why we are interested in conditional quantiles. So for example, you may know some variables better than others, and you may want to estimate some quantile, knowing some quantiles of a quantity, knowing other quantities. So that's what I will show on some example next. And as I mentioned briefly, I am much more interested in quantile-oriented sensitivity analysis, which requires the estimation of conditional quantiles. Okay, so some example. First of all, a financial example. So, for example, if the picture is too small, I think you can enlarge it if you want to see better the pictures. So, for example, you may consider four assets. So here are assets in US and in Europe. Assume that you know these assets quite well. And you may want to estimate some risk measure for some Japanese financial index. So, for example, you know these four U.S. and European financial index, and you want to have some information on quantiles on or other maybe other risk measures of the Japan edge equity fund. So that's an example, and we will present at the end of this morning talk a way to answer this question. And also you may have several it's Switzerland. I guess that everybody recognized the shape of Switzerland. So there are many spatial contexts also where conditional quantiles can be very pertinent. For example, so here you have the picture of some these are precipitation amounts on several places of Switzerland. So you may, for example, know all these black points. You may have the information on all these black points, and you may want, for example, to have information on some place here where you have no measure. So in that case, you want to estimate some risk measures of X of S. So maybe X is the precipitation amounts, and you want to estimate some quantile of X, knowing the distribution of all these black points. So this is another example that I will not go further on this. And finally, in this introduction part, I would like to mention some background on uncertainty. So, because as I said before, we are interested in quantile-oriented sensitivity analysis. So what is uncertainty? Imagine that you have some function f, which is a mathematical or numerical model. Usually f is either a computational code, or this is something like a black box, so you don't have access to f, but you have access to f of x for several values of x. So x are input parameters, and y is the output. So y is f of x, and for example, so there is here an example. You have the profit and loss amount at time one, and XI maybe the different lines of insurance portfolio. So you may have automobile claims, home insurance, asset management, and so on. And the purpose of uncertainty quantification is to consider that the inputs X are uncertain, and then you will model them as a random variable. So you consider that X is a random vector, and usually you know the distribution P. Sometimes you don't know, but usually you know the distribution P, and you want to evaluate how the uncertainty on X will have some impact on the uncertainty of Y. So this is the global frame of sensitivity analysis. So you can find some survey in Salteri, for example. And so the idea is really to quantify this, how the uncertainty of X impacts the uncertainty of Y. And you have a way to do this, which is done by what is called Sobol indices, which have been proposed by Sobol in 1993. So what are Sobol indices? So you consider the variance of the conditional expectation of Y knowing Xi. So here, so you recall that you have X, which is a vector, X1, X2, Xd. And for each variable Xi, you will define an index. So you consider the conditional expectation Y knowing Xi, and you consider this variance, and you divide by the total variance. So in some sense, you want to know which part of the variance of X. Which part of the variance of Y is due to Xi. If the Xi's are independent, then you have a nice decomposition of the variance, and you can do many things that we will see later on. If the Xi's are not independent, then things are more complicated, and I will not go in details in this direction. So for the moment, the Xi's are independent, and we can use the decomposition of the variance. So you may write this quantity Si in different ways. For example, it will rise as because of the total variance formula. You may write this like the variance of Y minus the expectation of the conditional variance. And if you write this like that, then you see that you can write this as a minimization problem, because of course the variance is realized. You know that the variance is the expectation of Y minus its expectation squared. And you know that it realizes this minimum, and this is the same thing for the conditional variance. So you can see that the SI, in fact, can be rewritten as a minimization problem. You have a minimization here, which is unconditional, and you have here a minimization which is conditionally to XI. Okay, so when you have this formula, you can see also that finally the SI, the Sobol indices, will give you some information on the uncertainty of Y around its expectation, because you have this formula. So you consider the distance between Y and its expectation, and the distance between Y and its conditional expectation. So the Sobol indices give you some central information on the uncertainty, and for many reasons we may be interested in other in non-central information, and we may be interested in measuring the uncertainty around some different quantity, not the expectation. So remember this formula. So you have these indices, so that are seen as the minimum of a distance, which is a square distance between Y and theta, and the minimum of the conditional distance. So in the context of conditional oriented sensitivity analysis, we will focus not on the expectation, but on the quantile. And we consider this function, which we call psi alpha. So we have alpha between 0 and 1. And we consider this function y minus theta times alpha minus the indicator that y is smaller than theta. And why do we consider this function? Simply because when you consider the minimum of the expectation of this function psi, the minimum is which for the quantile of level alpha of y. So we take the previous formula on Sobol indices and simply we replace the square distance by the function psi, and in fact you see that the function psi is also a distance, but this is a dissymmetric distance. So probably I should have put some picture, because so I don't know if I can I don't know, probably I cannot make a picture, but this function psi is so this is a so you have a slope 1 minus alpha and then a slope alpha. So this represents also a distance, but this is it is not symmetric. Okay, so what will be called quantile oriented sensitivity index? They have been defined by Four and his co-authors. So you take just the same formula as for Sobol indices, but you replace the square distance by this function psi alpha. And then you define, so you have, so here you have the minimum over the expectation of psi alpha, and here you have the minimum over the conditional expectation. And so, as I said, this minimum is reached for the quantile. So you can rewrite this formula with this, with the quantile and the conditional quantile. Okay. So this is also one of my personal motivation to study conditional quantile, is that we would like to estimate this this quantity. Okay, so some properties, some very basic properties on the quantile oriented sensitivity index. The first of all is that they are between 0 and 1. If they are 0, then this means that y and xi are independent. And if they are 1, this means that y and xi, y is xi measurable. So you have the same for the Sobol indices. So this is some, some minimal requirements that we will have for sensitivity indices. And the example that we will treat at the end of the presentation, which will take place tomorrow, is some simple example where y is the observed ozone concentration, and x will be several variables, which are the type of the day, the temperature, the humidity, the wind, and try to figure out which of these variables have some influence on the quantile of y. So that will be the last example that we will have at the end of the presentation tomorrow. Okay, so this was some teasing for the and some modelization on what we will do. Just before going in the details of the estimation of conditional quantile, I would like to explain why it is complicated to estimate this this quantile-oriented sensitivity indices. For example, you may wonder why it is more complicated than estimating Sobol indices. So I will just put again the formula for Sobol indices. So you for Sobol indices, in fact, you have to estimate this conditional, for example, this conditional variance. Of course, you have also to estimate the variance, but we assume that we know how to estimate the variance. And finally, the point will be to estimate the conditional variance and then the expectation of this conditional variance. And for the variance, there is something which is which makes the things very much more easy, is that this part is only true for independent variables. What is the trick which makes the things much more easier for Sobol indices is that you may write the variance of the conditional expectation as a covariance. So you may, if you consider that you have two sets of x, so you have x and you have x prime, which have the same distribution and which are independent. And then if you replace just the E's coordinate of x prime, so you have all the primes but xi and then all the primes, and then you can prove this formula that the variance of the conditional expectation is simply the covariance between y and y prime. So assuming that you know how to simulate efficiently x and x prime, of course, if you know how to simulate x, then you can simulate, of course, many copies of x. And then you may have a simple estimation of this covariance. So this makes I would not say that this makes the estimation of Sobol indices easy, because there are lots of issues on that I will not speak about. But this makes things much more easier than for what we call quasi indices, because for quasi indices, so I will put it again. So you have to estimate this quantity. So this quantity is not so complicated because you have the quantile. So if alpha is not too close from one or from zero, let us assume that we know how to estimate this quantile. This is not a big problem. And then you will estimate the expectation with some, Monte Carlo. You will just make the empirical mean and that's it. And the problem will be to estimate this conditional quantile. So you may have several ways to estimate the conditional quantile, or the conditional distribution if you want to have some information on various quantiles. So you may have kernel methods. So for example, we did some work on that with a former PhD student who is Ibrahim Manyang, and there are also works by Thomas Born on the same subject. So kernel methods may allow to estimate the conditional quantile, but often we have problems in calibrating the window, which is something that everybody knows when you want to make some kernel estimation, you have the difficulty on the window. And also it requires a large number of calls of F. So you have to keep in mind that usually in the applications, not for in the applications that I have presented, but in the application on uncertainty quantification, which comes often from industrial applications, the function f is costly, which means that if you want to have one value of f, it may take some minutes and even some hours and sometimes even some days. So in some example, really the function f may be costly. So the kernel methods, that's the first thing that we have tried, and okay, of course it works, but it requires a large number of calls of f. And this is why we turn to some random forest method. And the good point is that at the end, we will see that we need less call to F, but the method in itself is time consuming nevertheless. Okay, so I think I finished this introduction part. I would like, oh, yes, before, Yes, I almost finished the introduction. I have some remarks, which is some simple remark. There is a case where everybody can understand that it is easy to compute the conditional quantile. This is the Gaussian case. Because so if you assume that the whole vector y and x are Gaussian, is a Gaussian vector with expectation mu and covariance matrix sigma. So you assume that sigma is invertible so that it is easier, but you can do things also if sigma is not invertible. In that case, the conditional law of y knowing x is normal distribution, is a normal law. And you can compute everything. You can compute the expectation and you can compute the variance with respect to mu and sigma, and the sigma here. So here, y is a random variable and x is a random vector. And then, of course, once you know that the conditional distribution of y knowing x is normal, then you can easily compute the conditional quantile. So I forgot to say that phi here is the distribution function of a centroid of reduced normal law. Okay, so this is the easy case in some sense. This is a case when, and then you just have to estimate the parameters of your Gaussian vector. Okay, there is another way to do things is to consider what is called quantile regression. So this has been, for example, proposed by Kronecker and Bassett. This is quite popular, I think, at least in economy literature. You can find this method quite often. What's the idea? The idea is to say, okay, we will consider that the conditional quantile is a linear combination of the input variables. Here I change a bit the notations. So here you have x1, which is a random vector, and x2 is a random variable, and you want to compute, to calculate the conditional quantile of x2 knowing x1. Okay, and the assumption of the quantile regression is that you may approximate the conditional quantile of x2 knowing x1 by a linear combination of the xi. So if you say you decide to approximate your conditional quantile with this linear combination. So the point is that you will have to estimate beta star and beta zero star. So how can you estimate beta star and beta zero star? You will use this function psi. I recall that psi gives you the conditional quantile with this formula. So the idea of quantile regression is just this is not this is to minimize the distance with respect to this function psi between x2 and this linear combination of the coordinates of x1. Okay, and some easy computation proves. So I will say it again later on. This is not hard to do because you just have to make this minimization, which is not hard because the function psi is a convex function. So you have all the convex optimization stuff to help you, and this is not a difficult task to get this minimum. So you can do it. In the case of the Gaussian case, in the Gaussian case, the conditional quantile and the quantile regression coincides. So in the Gaussian case, this is you can do the things either by estimating setting the parameter of the law or by minimizing this dysfunction. So in the caution case, everything is okay. And what we will see later on is that if you are not in the caution case, then things are not so easy. Okay, so there are many methods in order to estimate conditional quantiles. So I spoke on random forest, and that's what we will see this afternoon and tomorrow. There are also methods based on neural networks, on nearest networks. And for example, you can have a look on the paper by Leonard Torossian, who gave some survey on the various methods. So you have this survey, there are others, but this one is quite, I think it's quite interesting. Okay, so now I will turn to the part on elliptic distribution. So as I told you, in the case of normal distribution, you can easily compute the conditional quantile and estimate them. So at the first stage, we were focusing on elliptical distribution because elliptical distribution are not so far from Gaussian ones. It depends on the viewpoint, but on some viewpoints, they are not so far from Gaussian ones. So I will explain what are elliptical distribution. I will speak a little bit more on quantile regression, and then I will show you how you can manage for high-level quantiles. Okay, so what is an elliptic distribution? So a way to see it, and that's what you can find in the work by Kano. You just consider that an elliptic distribution is the mu, which is the expectation, and then you have epsilon, which is a positive random variable, and then you have a Gaussian vector. Centroid Gaussian vector. So in some sense, an elliptic distribution will be a normal distribution with random variance. So here you see that the conditionally to this Gaussian vector x has a variance epsilon, conditionally to the random variable epsilon, then X is a Gaussian vector with variance epsilon squared times sigma, so with covariance matrix epsilon squared times sigma. So this is why I said that elliptic distribution are not so far from Gaussian, because this is just a Gaussian distribution with random variance. Okay, so there are many ways to write elliptic distribution. So you have this way which I think is quite easier to understand. You may have some other ways that we will use later on, which are that the elliptical distribution we write as expectation. Then you have R, which is a positive random variable. Then you have lambda, which is a matrix, and lambda times its transpose is the matrix sigma that you have here. And then you have U, which is a uniform vector, uniformly distributed on the sphere of dimension d minus 1. And if you want to have some relation between R and epsilon, the point is that R in distribution equals some key variable times epsilon. So this is not too hard to see the relation between the two, but you need to have some computation on Gaussian vector and so on, but it is not so hard. So R will be called the radius of the elliptic distribution. So as I said, so key here is the squared, is the root of a key square distribution. And so this is what we call RD elliptical distribution. So R is for the radius, D is for the dimension, and the parameters are mu and sigma. So you can find this these definitions in the work by Cambanis, Hung, and Simons. Okay, so what are the properties of elliptic distributions? So I don't know if you are very familiar with elliptic distribution, but they have very nice properties that are close to the properties of Gaussian distributions. For example, if you consider a subvector of an elliptic distribution, then you get also an elliptic distribution. And so you just have to consider the blocks of the matrix sigma, and the components of the vector X will be elliptical with the matrix corresponding to their blocks in the matrix sigma. So this is really practical in many computations. What will be interesting for us is that conditional distributions of elliptic vectors are elliptical, and this is really what we will need, because as you understood, we want to estimate conditional quantiles, so we need to know the conditional distributions. So if you consider X2 knowing X1, then it is still elliptical, and you can express the radius of this conditional distribution with respect to the radius of the global vector. So you have you assume that X is an elliptical distribution, and the radius is this random variable. And if you have a combination, if you consider the conditional distribution of, so you have X, which you decompose into X1 and X2, so X is elliptical. You know that X1 and X2 are elliptical, but you also know that the conditional distribution is elliptical, and you have this relation between R and the radius of the conditional distribution. The point is that this R star is not really easy to deal with, because you see, so you have R, okay, let us assume that we know R. Then you have some beta distribution. You have a beta distribution of parameter d1 over 2 and d2 over 2. So d1 is the dimension of the vector x1, and d2 is the dimension of the vector x2. And then you have c11, which is the root of the matrix sigma 11. So you see that this R star is a bit complicated, because you have the radius R, you have the square of 1 minus beta with beta distribution, and then you have to condition this distribution here with that one, which involves also R, beta, U, which is the uniform distribution on the sphere, you have to condition with this random variable when it is equal to this quantity. Okay, so we have an exact formula for the conditional distribution, we should be able to manage with the conditional quantiles if we know how to compute this distribution R star. Finally, a last property of elliptical distribution is that the linear combination of coordinates are elliptical, and this is really easy to see because you have this formulation with the Gaussian vector, and of course a linear combination of Gaussian the coordinates of a Gaussian vector is still Gaussian, and so you have the same result for elliptical distribution. So this is quite easy, this is not too complicated, and this is a computation which is okay, you can do it. But then the main problem will be to manage with this R star. Okay, so some examples. So we recall this the formulation of the elliptical distribution. So you have this Gaussian vector times a positive random variable. And of course, depending on the choice of epsilon, you have different forms for the elliptical distribution. So for example, if epsilon equals 1, then of course you have a normal distribution, okay? You have student distributions. So if you consider epsilon, which is nu divided by a key, the square root of nu divided by a key square, then you get student distributions. If you take for epsilon a Pareto distribution, generalized Pareto distribution, then you get what is called slash distribution. So you see that student distribution have more EV tails than normal distribution, and slash distribution have heavier tails than student distribution. You see that it goes to zero at infinity, but quite slowly. On the contrary, you can consider Laplace distribution. So Laplace distribution is related to exponential distribution. Here you see that you have really tiny q's, in fact, in the distribution. So you can see that on these examples, you have many different forms for the elliptical distribution. So you have normal distribution, you have heavy tails distribution, and you have really low tails distribution. Okay, and you have many other classes that you just choose a positive random variable epsilon, and this gives you some class of elliptical distributions. As I said, we are interested in conditional quantiles for elliptical distribution, and it is a simple computation which you use. So you consider that if you have that X is elliptical distribution in dimension one, so one here is for dimension one. So this means that X writes like this, where U1, so U1 will be the uniform distribution of the on the sphere of dimension zero. So this means that U1 is minus one or one with probability 1/2. So if you write things like that, you can see that the quantile of X writes like as mu plus sigma, and then you have the inverse of the distribution function of R, and then you have to take the quantile 2 alpha minus 1 because of this random variable U1. So you have an easy formulation for the quantile in dimension for the elliptical distribution in dimension 1, and if you consider a random vector which is elliptical in dimension n plus 1 with reduced R. So you will be interested in the quantile of x2 knowing x1. So as we said before, the distribution of x2 knowing x1 is elliptical. Is elliptical in dimension one, and you simply write this formula for the distribution x2 knowing x1, and then you have to manage with this distribution function of R star. And as I said before, the problem is that the distribution of R star is quite difficult to access. Even in simple example, for student distribution, you can compute the distribution of R star, it's not too hard, but for others, it can be really complicated. Okay, so we want to find some other ways to deal with this and to avoid the computation of this R star distribution. So the first idea was to go to quantile regression. So I explained before what is quantile regression. And in the case of elliptical distribution, you can compute, you have this formula for beta star and you have this expression for the quantile regression estimator. So you just have the conditional expectation here. Here you have the conditional covariance matrix. And here you have the inverse of the distribution function of R. So if you remember what is the exact quantile, sorry, the exact quantile for the exact conditional quantile, so this is exactly this formula, and here you have R star. And if you make the computation with the condition, the quantile regression, then you have the same formula, but you have here the distribution function of R rather than the distribution function of R star. So this is in some sense quite satisfactory because you don't have complicated things to estimate here. And you have also the exact distribution of the regression quantile. So the regression quantile here follows an elliptical distribution in dimension one with these parameters. Okay, so the question is how good is this regression quantile for elliptic distributions? So as we said before, in the Gaussian case, the regression quantile and the exact quantile coincides. So this is really good. And if you are not in the Gaussian case, for example, if you are in the student case, then so this is the regression quantile. So you have this. So here, this is the inverse distribution of the student law. And you see that the difference between the real conditional quantile and the quantile regression, of course, this is this function here, and it may be quite different because, of course, here you have the distribution function of the student law of new degrees of freedom, and here you have the distribution function of the student law of new plus n degrees of freedom, and you have also this this quantity behind with d1, which is the Malaubis distance. And if you consider, for example, n equals 5, this means that the vector x1 has dimension 5. Then you see that, so you have this picture, so maybe it is a bit small, you can enlarge it. So you have, this is a QQ plot with the theoretical quantile, because for student distribution, we know how to compute the conditional quantile with this formula. And here you have the regression quantile. And you see that in the middle of the distribution, so which means that for quantile close to 1/2, it is not so bad, but if you go to high level quantiles and even not so high, then this is not good. And this is a general fact. In fact, the regression quantile is not good in general if you go away from Gaussian distributions. Okay, so what did we do? So we focused on high level quantiles in order to make this problem here, to resolve this problem of high level quantiles. So what did we do in the case when alpha is close to one? We proposed an equivalent of this inverse of the distribution function of R star, because remember that if you want to compute the exact, if you want to compute the exact conditional quantile, you need to have to compute this inverse of the distribution function of R star. So that's what we did, and we did this only for high-level quantiles. So the result, so I do not give all the technical assumptions because, they are satisfied for many elliptical distributions, but they are not so easy to write. So you have some technical assumption that ensures that you have some parameter L and eta, which gives you this equivalency between the inverse of the distribution function of R star and the inverse of the distribution function of R. And once you have that, you may have a good approximation of conditional quantile when alpha is large enough. I mean, when alpha is close enough to one. Okay, so here are some examples where you can you can compute the parameter A, eta and L. So in the Gaussian case, of course, you just take L equal 1 and eta equal 1. In the student case, you have this formula, which are not so nice, but everything is computable because you have the gamma, these gamma functions here and here. So you can compute it. And this means that you can make the estimations. Okay, and to finish on with this session, I would like to give some examples. So for the moment, the only case where we know how to compute explicitly the conditional quantiles is for the student case. So here you have a QQ plot with the theoretical quantile and the extremal correction that we did with the formula before. So of course, in the middle, for alpha close to 1/2, this is not good because our method is good only for alpha close to 1. And you can see that for high-level quantiles, you have good approximation of the true quantiles. Okay, so this is a simulation example for the student case. And I would like also to mention that we can make the estimation because, of course, if you know, if you consider this table, if you know that you have a slash distribution, then you know how to compute eta and L. And then you put your eta and L in this formula, and then you have your approximation. But of course, in general, you don't know that, I mean, if I give you some data, you don't know if you are slash or not. And then a work that Antoine Ouseglio Carlev did is to make the estimations of the parameter L, eta, and gamma. Gamma, which is the index of the tail. Okay, and to finish, so that we can have some time for some questions if you have, I would like to go back to the financial example that I gave you in the introduction. So you have these four financial indices from US and from Europe, and assume that you know these variables, you know these indices, sorry, and you want to anticipate on the return of the WisdomTree Japan Edge Equity Fund. So we will call it X2. And what we would like to do is to estimate the quantile of X2, knowing X1, which will be these four indices. Okay, so we had some sample of size more than 2,500, and we have it on some. Okay, so we consider only we keep the last value, and we consider this as the learning sample. And we want to focus on the last day. So on the last day, we have these values for X1. And what we would like to do is to estimate the quantile of X2, which is the Japanese index, knowing X1, which are these returns. So if we want to apply what we did before, we have to see if the rule vector x1, x2 is more or less elliptical. So there is some data exploration which shows that the daily returns may be considered as independent. So this is okay, more or less okay. So this means that you have no influence on time, and then you can consider that you have a sample of the data, of the distribution, sorry, independent sample of the distribution. Also, one point which is important is that with the construction of elliptical distribution, you see that these are symmetrical distributions. So you have to figure out if your distribution is more or less symmetrical, and this is the case on the example. And also, one point is that if you have an elliptical distribution, all the tails must have the same index. And that's what we observe on the data. So we decided that we can assume that the vector x1, x2 is elliptical. And then we applied our method in order to estimate the quantiles. So here you have the picture of the quantile estimation from level 0.8 to almost 1. And if you want, for example, to see for a high level quantile, you have this this value 3.1 for the 3.1% for the estimation of the VAR of this Japanese index. Okay, so I think I finished for this part. So I just would like to make some conclusion on this part. And then for this afternoon and tomorrow, I will focus on random forest estimation and on quantile-oriented sensitivity analysis. So I would like to insist on the fact that regression quantile is not good for non-Gaussian distribution. So maybe it's obvious for all of us, but I must say that I saw several papers saying that okay, we make quantile regression for estimating conditional quantile, and I think this is not a good idea if you are far from Gaussian. Okay, what we did can be adapted for many risk distribution risk measures such as TVAR, LP quantile, and other risk measures. If you are in high dimension, which means that n is large, then you need other techniques, and this is part of the work by Antoine, who did this after his PhD. Okay, so I put the references of the work, and the point is that, as we saw, quantile regression is not so bad in the center of the distribution, and we have methods for extreme levels. The question is, what can we do in between if you are not close, if alpha is not close to 1/2? And if it is not close to 1, what kind of hybrid method can we imagine to estimate the quantiles, for example, at level 0.7? And also, I said that elliptical distributions are symmetric. So if you are not symmetric, you cannot do what we did here. And so maybe there are some other things to do in that direction. So I would like to thank you very much. Maybe I was a bit too long, but probably I will be shorter this afternoon or tomorrow.
No, Véronique, thank you very much for the presentation. It was not too long. It was very interesting. And you mentioned Sobol indices. This reminds me on the visit of Ilya Sobol here in Graz, just when Soviet Union broke down, and it was his first visit in the West. He equitized his index. It was 93, just the time of the paper you mentioned. And he also equitized his Sobol sequence, which was mentioned by Stefan in the previous talk as a very good low discrepancy sequence for simulations. And at that time, I wrote a paper with Sobol. It was really nice that you mentioned this index today. So it's thank you very much. Once again, it's open for discussion. Please ask questions to this first part. And please, I remind you, collect questions for the discussion session in the afternoon. So I see there is a question prepared just now.
Yes, so there is this question by Christian Robert. So
yes.
So I can put again the expression of R star. So where is it? Okay, no, it's I don't remember where it is. Oh no, it was much before, sorry. Okay, so here it is, the distribution of R-star. So I don't think that it is so complicated if n increases, because you see that the main difficulty finally is to have some information of this, so of this conditional distribution. So this is R, so R is simply a random vector, a positive random variable, so it is easy. Beta is a beta distribution, so the influence of the dimension is in the beta. So because you have a beta, so D1 and D2 are the dimension of X1 and X2. So in some sense, no, so D1 plus D2 equals N. So the impact of the dimension is in the beta. So I don't think that the complexity is increasing with N. For me, the complexity is really on this formula, because you have this conditional distribution of this distribution, which is not so complicated, knowing this quantity. And I mean, we did not succeed to do anything with that, except in the student case.
Yeah, there is another question, or two questions, by Suman Gua. So can you read the questions?
Yes, sure. Okay. So, okay, welcome, Christian. and Suman, so can COSA be used as a test statistic to test independent between Y and X? So the point is maybe, but for the moment we, and that's what I would speak about this afternoon and tomorrow, we have many difficulties to estimate the COSA indices. And we are far from having some interval confidence of the COSA indices. So if we have a good estimation procedure with confidence interval, then maybe, yes, we could use it for a test. But for the moment, for the moment, no. That's what I would say. And the other question, can COSA be used an improved measure of correlation like distance correlation? I think there are indices that are more in that direction. You have indices that are called H-seq indices, and they are more in this direction of computing a distance between the conditional distribution of Y knowing Xi and the distribution of Y. So I would, the COSA indices are really focused on the on the quantiles. So you really want to know what are the impacts of different variables on the quantile. I think the H-seq indices are more in the direction of what you want. So you have papers by, for example, Sébastien Davega, who studied this and who had this point of view of distance more than for COSA.
Further fast questions, because we have a lot of time in the discussion session. So
yes, and I will be in the discussion session this afternoon. So
okay, thank you. So please collect questions that we have material for the discussion session. Yes, so of course now it would be time to go to the restaurant at Zieren, which is a very nice place. Nevertheless, the restaurant is closed, so we have to eat some sandwiches somewhere, and we hope to meet, and please don't forget, 2:00 in the afternoon, and we are happy that Veronique gives her second part there. So thank you very much, and see you later.
Thank you. See you later.